about quantization of free scalar fields. And the last example I want to discuss, it's a very slight generalization of the case of a single real scalar field, but it will allow me to introduce some extra ingredients will be useful later. So the case I want to discuss today is the case of the quantization of a complex scalar field. Complex scalar field with a U1 symmetry, okay? And the U1 symmetry just maps pi to phi times the phase. But remember, if we put a subscript charge here. Okay? So if I restrict the theory to have this U1 symmetry, this is the most general Lagrangian you can write at the quadratic level of a complex scalar field. Okay? So we already started the theory, you remember, at the classical level. So I will just discuss what changes at the quantum level. First of all, as usual, we have to identify the variables and the conjugate momenta. So here you have two variables, right? Phi and, so at the classical level you have phi star. At the quantum level these will become operators. So this will become a phi dagger, which is the Michell conjugate. Okay? We take the complex conjugate for the real number part, and for the operators that will be inside the phi, the A dagger, you take a complex conjugate. Okay? Now phi is not anymore equal to phi dagger. So the most general solution will have independent coefficient A and B inside the plane waves. Okay? We'll see explicitly. Well, then we have to identify the conjugate momenta. So the conjugate momentum of phi is the L in B phi dot is phi dot dagger. Right? If you do the derivative with respect to phi dot, you get phi dot dagger. And the conjugate momentum of phi dagger instead is phi dot. So you see that now the field and its complex conjugate are paired and mixed. Okay? Phi dot is not the complex conjugate, it's the conjugate momentum of phi, but it's the conjugate momentum of phi dagger. And phi dot dagger is the. So which means that when you impose the commutation relation, you shouldn't require that the commutator of phi and phi dot is equal to I delta, but you have to require that the commutator of phi x phi dot dagger of y at space-time separated point at equal times is equal to the I delta 3 x minus y. And similarly for phi dagger x phi dot y at x dot equal to y dot. And must satisfy the commutation relation of the kind. All other commutators are space-like separation point are required to vanish. So the commutator of phi and phi dot and the commutator of phi dagger phi dagger dot, and so on, they all must vanish at equal time. Okay? So these are the commutation relation that you have to impose to the system. Okay, then you just write the most general solution of the equation motion like we did for the real scalar field. So phi of x
remind you, it's d3 p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, a tilde p e to the minus I p x, plus d tilde p dagger e to the I p x.
Now this coefficient is not anymore the complex conjugate of the other. Phi is a complex field, so as in general independent coefficients. And now this independent coefficient becomes independent operators inside phi. So this is a solution, complex solution to the equation of motion. And similarly for phi dagger.
P tilde P into minus I P X plus A tilde dagger into the I P X.
So all you have to do now is the exercise we did already for the real scalar field. Invert these relations and write A, E dagger, B, and B dagger as combination of phi dagger, phi dot, and phi dot dagger. Okay. And after you do that, you start computing the commutation relations for A's and B's, given the commutation relation that you impose to the field. You can do this as an exercise, to which I'll give you the result. The result is not very striking. So the commutator of A, P, A dagger, Q is equal to 2 pi Q, 2 omega P, delta 3 of P minus Q. And the same is true for the commutator of DP and it is the dagger Q. While all other commutators vanish. A tilde P with, for example, B tilde Q. A tilde P with B Q dagger. A tilde P with A Q. And so on, they're all zero. So what you find is that basically the system is described now for each momentum p. There are two harmonic oscillators, one of type A and one of type B. And they are completely decoupled, since they're commutators. Okay. Well, you could have expected the result given that you can always rewrite this Lagrangian in terms of two scalar fields. So the Lagrangian would be just the sum of two free massive scalar field Lagrangians. The Hamiltonian would be the sum. You'll get the Hamiltonian of the sum of two decoupled harmonic oscillators for each momentum p. So this is just a different basis. Okay?
So if we now extract the Hamiltonian to pack up, it will produce two momenta.
Exactly. Now we write the Hamiltonian. So all you have to do is just take the usual expression for Hamiltonian, replace phi and phi dagger, phi dots and phi dot dagger, do all the integrals, and what you find, you do the exercise, is that expression for the Hamiltonian is the usual prefactors, omega p, and then there is a factor a tilde dagger p ap plus b tilde p dagger bp And then there are the commutators, plus 1/2 the commutator of A dagger, plus 1/2 the commutator of BB dagger, which are the usual infinite terms that we don't care because they are constant. Okay? So indeed, the full Hamiltonian is the sum of two Hamiltonians of two harmonic oscillators for each momentum P. So it will be the number operator for the oscillator of type A, the number operator for the oscillator of type B, weighted with the energy. The two oscillators are independent, but they share exactly the same mass. So the dispersion relation, the relation between energy, omega, and momentum P is exactly the same. The omega P in front of them is the same. So you see that now phi applied to the vacuum creates a particle of type B. Instead, phi dagger creates a particle of type A. And similarly, phi can be used to annihilate a particle of type A, and phi dagger annihilates a particle of type B. Now, the extra property of this Lagrangian now is was in the fact that now we have a continuous global symmetry, U1, just rotating the field, phi, which means that there will be a conserved current and a conserved charge. So the expression for the current we already got, so was right here, oops, sorry, that's okay. J mu was equal to I Q minus phi dagger d mu with double arrow phi. And the charge was the integral in V3x of J naught, and J naught is just IQ times phi dot dagger phi minus phi dot phi dagger. As before, now you have to replace in phi dot for the darker all the expression, you get an expression in terms of A and B, right? Already here you can see some problem, or if you know, well defined, is the fact that here we have a product of phi and phi dot dagger, and phi dot and phi dagger, which do not commute. In particular, they compute exactly at the same point, which will give infinite, okay? So I already expect something infinite, and the result will depend how you actually write this thing. I write it in this way, I could have written with this phi and phi dot dagger changes, and you will not have, you will get a different result because the commutator is moving. Okay, let me ignore the issue for the moment. Let me keep going with the computation. If you replace all the terms there, you will get something which look like following. You have a Q, now you have an integral in V3P over 2 pi Q, 1 over 2 omega P, as usual. Right. Then you have a B tilde dagger P B P minus A tilde dagger P A P. Forget tilde. Well, if you just get choose this order, you get again some divergent commutator. This minus this. And if you actually chose another ordering for these operators, you see the different ordering will just shift the result by constant, and that constant goes into different coefficients for this term, which means that these terms depend on the ordering, are not well defined. Moreover, they're infinite, as infinite was that. But more importantly, they are constant. So it gives you a constant shift infinite to your definition of charge, but it's constant. So you can always subtract it. You can always subtract to a conserved quantity a constant, and the new quantity will still be conserved. Because it's subtracted a constant. So it's just a redefinition of your constant.
So it doesn't have physical meaning?
It doesn't have a physical meaning.
Not like the energy?
Like the energy.
Of real scalar field, so we should proceed from here to real scalar field if we impose by the identify condition from the chart.
Yes. Phi equal to phi dagger means A equal to B.
Yes.
So you get an extra factor of 2. Here, but the extra factor of 2 has to do with the fact that if you now take phi equal to phi dagger, this is not canonically normalized anymore. There is a factor of 2 there. So if it's not canonically normalized, you will see that the canonical momentum here is twice phi dot, and then when you impose the commutation relation, it will react. You will find that A, the commutator of A dagger requires a factor of extra 2 here, and that factor of extra 2 with this factor of extra 2 cancel, in the sense that now your number operator is 2 A dagger A, because the commutation of A dagger is not 1 but it's 2, and then at the end you get this exact result. Or in any case, you can rescale phi by square root of 2. And at the end, you get the same Lagrangian. And of course, this vanishes because if we take equal to B, it doesn't exist. Alright, so let's go back here. So you start seeing that there are more and more of these infinities coming out. That can actually be shifted away by a constant. So there is a procedure to get rid once and for all of this annoying infinities, which only works in special cases, in particular for free theories or some lower dimensional theories with interactions. The full procedure to get rid of all the infinities is a renormalization that you will see next semester. For this course, it will be enough the procedure I'm introducing now. And the procedure I'm introducing is, well, it's very dumb. It's called normal ordering. And but it's defined at the level of creation and relation operator. Is defined as a reordering of this operator. So if you have a string of creation and relation operator, let's say a dagger a with different momenta, like p1, p2, and there could be b or something, doesn't matter. By definition, normal ordering of this product of operator is just the product of the same operators ordered in such a way that all creation operators are before and all annihilation operators are after. So this will be equal to a dagger p2, a dagger pn minus 1, and then there are all the annihilation operators, a p1, a pn. Okay? Just print all the creation operators before on the left and all annihilation on the right. This is just a definition of this operation. And then we just use this normal ordering in front of your Lagrangian Hamiltonian. And this automatically gets rid of all these commutators. Because if you remember, these commutators were coming from the fact that in the computation we're getting a dagger A plus a dagger. If you take the normal ordering, it will just give you 2 times a dagger A without the commutator. So it's automatically subtracting the commutator. You can see, for example, for 2 operators, so the normal ordering of a dagger is equal to a dagger A, by definition. Instead, a dagger was equal to a dagger A plus the commutator. So what the normal ordering is doing is just subtracting all the commutators. And this generalized to products of operators. Another way to see this is the following. The normal ordering, for example, of 2 operators, a dagger, we can also write as a dagger itself minus the vacuum expectation value of a dagger. In fact, you can see it from here. A dagger is equal to a dagger A minus plus the commutator. Right? The first piece, a dagger A on the vacuum, gives you 0. The second piece is actually the commutator, is just a number. So you can bring it outside the matrix element. So the vacuum is normalized to 1. So this guy here is just the commutator itself. So you are subtracting from the original object just the commutator. So at the level of charge, the normal order charge is also equal to the charge itself minus the expectation value on the vacuum of the charge. This is just a number, actually it will be infinite, but it's a constant. So you're subtracting from your definition of Q a constant. If Q is conserved, this is a constant, the normal order Q is conserved, and now it's finite. So you can use this as your definition of charge. Similar for the Hamiltonian. You can do the normal ordering of the Hamiltonian we just subtract to the Hamiltonian the value in zero, that is maybe infinite, but it's a constant. And the new normal order Hamiltonian is again conserved, finite, and you can use it as a definition of energy.
This definition is for any operator. You want a normal order?
Yes.
So it means that the expectation value of the normal order operator in the vacuum is always zero.
Yes. Yes.
Couldn't we just from the beginning construct the commutation relationship so that they don't give us this infinity?
I don't know how. I don't know how. Try. All right, so now that we defined this object here, let's go back. So let's now work with the normal ordered charge. Sometimes you'll find notation normal order with the n in front. Sometimes normal order is also symboled by putting columns like this. The blackboard is easier to draw an N. But this is an alternative notation. And okay, so let's go back to the charge. So let's see what the charge means now. You see, the charge is what? It's the number operators for the excitation type B, minus the number operator for the excitation of type A, weighted with the prefactor Q. This means that the charge of some state is just n, the number of particle B times Q, minus the number of particle A times Q, which means that each particle of type B will have a charge Q, each particle type A has a charge minus Q. Measure, for example, if you take the one particle state of type A and you apply Q, you will return from here minus Q times itself. If you take the particle one particle state type B and you apply Q, you will get plus Q times itself. So the numbers, the particle states with definite number of type A and B are also again states of this charge operator with different degree value. So here you see the advantage of choosing the complex basis versus rewriting the Lagrange in terms of real scalar fields. If you were to write the real scalar field, that Lagrangian would have had a symmetry which was SO2, which is equivalent to U1. But under SO2, the action of SO2 is to rotate the two fields between themselves. So the particles of each of these fields will not be an eigenstate of the charge operator. They will be rotated one in the other. So if you want the complex basis is the one that also diagonalizes the charge. So if you want to classify your states in terms of energy and charge, which commute with energy, you use the complex basis. Questions?
In the real basis, Q would and the real basis I used phi 1 and phi 2 real fields.
Yes.
Or the form of Q will change.
Yes. Yes.
How do you know that?
You know the form of Q. You know the form of Q at this level. We computed for SON. There will be the generator of SON. In case of SO2, the generator is just zero, the anti-symmetric 2 by 2, right? It's sigma 2, or I sigma 2. So you will have phi 1, phi 2, minus phi 2, phi 1. And here you'll get basically B dagger A minus A dagger B, or sorry, A1 dagger A2 minus A2 dagger A1, which means that when you act on a particle type 1, you'll get a particle type 2, and they will mix.
Will the Hamiltonian be diagonal in the real basis?
Yes, because yes. It will be still a sum of, because of the symmetry, if you just do an O2 rotation, the return is invariant.
But if it's a conserved charge, then it must commute with Hamiltonian.
Yes.
Then you can
diagonalize both. And this is the basis of diagonalize both, not the basis of real scalar field. There is an extra symmetry in this Lagrangian. And there is no systematic way to get it. There is a Z2 symmetry acting how? Phi minus phi. Yes. There's another one.
Phi.
One at a time. You?
Phi.
Phi in?
Multiplied by I.
Phi multiplied by I. So phi goes into I phi, but this symmetry here is part of this. If you choose alpha equal to pi over 2. Another one?
Phi dagger to minus phi dagger.
Phi dagger in?
Minus phi dagger.
Minus phi dagger, mm-hmm. Yes. So there is, no, actually, phi in minus phi comes together with phi dagger in minus phi dagger, right? It's all 1 is 2.
So phi to phi dagger.
Phi to phi dagger, yes. Indeed, this actually was also part of the U1 with I pi. The real new symmetry is this, phi into phi dagger. Okay? This is a Z2 symmetry, it's a discrete symmetry. And the action of this symmetry at the level of A and B is simple. It's just exchanging A with B. So it's changing, A and B are associated to two different particles with the same mass, same momentum, same spectrum, but opposite charge. And they are called one the antiparticle of the other. Forgot. Because they are exactly the same quantum number except the opposite charge. Okay? And this is Z2 symmetry exchange this particle with antiparticles. The exchange particle with the positive charge, particle with negative charge. This is Z2 symmetry is called charge conjugation.
There is no Lagrangian
in
nature that has more than two fields?
Like the standard model?
I don't know. Because here we have two fields and we have particle and antiparticle. So if we have three fields, for example, how is the relation between
them? No. At most you have a Z2 that relates particle and antiparticles. Then you can combine that Z2 with SON and rotate the particle between themselves. But we will see that this Z2, which is charge conjugation, is actually, it mixes with the Lorentz group, the Poincaré group. So it's, in some sense, it's special. unlike the other Z2 symmetry, like phi minus phi. I finished the room. Erase here. So as we did yesterday for Poincaré symmetry.
Does this symmetry have an invariant? Complex conjugate.
This charge conjugation. Yeah, there are invariants. Like psi modulus squared is an invariant.
Okay.
So from product of phi phi dagger is invariant.
From modulus theorem.
Huh?
From conserved quantity.
This is asymmetry, right? Mm. So the you mean a charge?
Yeah.
There is a charge which is the Z2 charge associated to charge conjugation. There is no current because for discrete symmetry there is no Noether theorem. Mm. But you can define a charge, which is the one charge conjugation. So under the action of a charge conjugation, phi goes to phi dagger, particle goes into antiparticles. Things that are invariant with this transformation remain invariant in the evolution.
But how does the charge look like in this case?
How the charge?
The conserved charge, how does it look like?
Interesting.
It will be conserved, this charge. This charge will be conserved.
Yeah, it's a symmetry, so it's conserved. So
by which theorem?
Huh?
Like
no, there is no conserved current, so there is no Noether theorem, but since it's a symmetry, it commutes with Hamiltonian. So under time evolution, it doesn't change. So if you take an eigenstate, or you can take eigenstates of the charge and the Hamiltonian itself, they diagonalize. So the Hamiltonian evolution doesn't mix states with different charge conjugation.
Well, what determines this charge? Because I can put in any quantity that has phi squared and it would be invariant.
Now, for example, you can take a process. So, what you should think about this what the implication of this symmetry is the following: take a process and compute the process. For example, the probability that something happens in the process. The symmetry tells you that if you take the charge conjugated process, that has the same probability. So if you take, for example, we will see that you take the scattering of particles, the symmetry will tell you that now if you take a scattering of antiparticles, we'll get exactly the same result. So, what I wanted to say to finish this subject was the analogy that we did, analogy what I said yesterday about the conservation of charges for Poincaré symmetry. You can repeat the same procedure we did yesterday for the global ones. So you can define a transformation U that acts on the states, psi, which implements at the quantum level the transformation, this symmetry transformation which was we used at the classical level for the field phi. And the representation of this operator U, unitary operator, is just e to the I q times the generator of the transformation a derivative operator which is this Q operator which is exactly this. And so you remember the identity we wrote yesterday, that udag phi u must match with the variation of phi at the classical level, so with e to the I alpha q, sorry, this was alpha. This depends on the parameter of the transformation. To the alpha q times phi. So there is this identity between the operator phi, the transformation operator u, and the parameter of the transformation. So, for example, you could have started like yesterday from here, requiring the matrix elements of transforming like you expect by the symmetry, and now apply this identity at the level of fields, and you will derive that the representation of u is actually this. Because when you apply this to a state, it must, each state will rotate with a phase, which is e to the I alpha q, and the rotation is thus
the phi is both sides of the equation is evaluated as simple.
Yes. Now I'm not touching any coordinates, these are internal symmetries, so they commute to the Poincaré group, so they don't, they only act like in this case, phi was transforming as simple. And as of yesterday, you can expand now this in alpha for infinitesimal alpha and match the two quantities, and you'll find that from here you get I alpha the commutator of q with phi, and on the right hand side the variation of phi, which is proportional to I alpha q times phi. So there is a non-trivial identity between the commutation of q and the field. It returns something proportional to the field itself. Notice this identity is only based on symmetries. So this identity will survive also when you add interactions. At that point, it will tell you something highly non-trivial, because you will not be able to write explicitly anymore the field in terms of any diagrams or everything explicitly. But this identity will stay.
Yes. If I have an interaction that breaks the U1 symmetry, then it will then survive.
It will not, yeah. Mm. So the importance of having a symmetry is you have a symmetry. If you don't have a symmetry.
What was your statement, sorry? Maybe I didn't get it correctly.
If that this identity will survive.
Yeah.
As long? When you add interactions.
Uh-huh.
That doesn't seem.
Ah, okay.
That's if you have a symmetry, of course.
Yes.
I have one question. Written in that way, this transformation is just a multiplication by a scalar. Like a prefactor. Like
which one? This
the
one?
I alpha q.
This one?
No, the one above.
This one?
Yes.
Yes, this is just a phase.
So I can absorb that in the field. So any theory that can be written in terms of quadratic terms will have a U1 symmetry.
No.
Because of that.
No, because you could have added here terms that are of the form phi square plus phi dagger square. And now a phase rotation is not a symmetry anymore.
Nice.
So I required that the Lagrangian was not the most general quadratic one, but was one with a symmetry. The symmetry buys you a very important property. You see, if I consider this theory here, there will still be two fields, with two harmonic oscillators. But now if you do the math, you will find that the two harmonic oscillators will have different masses. One will have like m plus m tilde and the other m minus m tilde when you diagonalize all these terms. So the symmetry is telling you that the two particles, particle and antiparticle in this case, has exactly the same mass. This is more evident if you write in terms of real scalar field. Then you have an SO2 that rotates one in the other. So the mass must be the same. If the mass is different, it starts rotating and we cannot rotate, right? More questions?
For this theory, can you still find a conserved charge?
Like which one? This one?
Yeah, with this last term there.
No. This is the sum of, if you write everything in real fields, this will be the sum of two Lagrangian of real fields, one with mass m1 and one with mass m2. Each of them that don't have any continuous symmetry, and put it together, there is no symmetry. The most general. So theories with symmetries are less general, in a sense, because they constrain the number of terms you can write and the form of the parameters. For example, in this case, it forces the two masses of the two fields to be exactly the same. And in general, with the other interaction, we constrain the interaction to be much less general than what they could be without the symmetry. Exactly like in classical physics, if you have a symmetric object, it's more constrained than an object without symmetry.
Symmetry. Is it allowed only for the module square of a certain field, I mean complex field? So is there other forms rather than this form which will have a U1 symmetry?
Yeah, when you start adding more, well, yes, maybe.
Is it only?
I have to think, maybe with more. Well, to make an invariant, you cannot make invariants only with phi. To make invariants, you need phi and phi dagger, right? If you only have phi, any power of phi will not be invariant. Phi will always have a positive charge, will rotate to the same phase. So you need something that rotates to the opposite phase to cancel and make an invariant. So eventually you will need, if you have only this field phi, you only have the same number of phi dagger than phi. Of course, they could be saturated a different way. So for example, you can have a phi dagger box phi operator. These are higher derivatives. Well, there are two derivatives, but actually it's equivalent to that up to total derivative. But for example, you can have this. Now it's an inequivalent operator. But this requires more powers of the field, so these are interactions. With more fields, you have more freedom. So if you have more fields, you can combine them in different ways if they transform with different phases to produce invariants. Okay. Now the last. The last thing I want to mention is, like for the real scalar field, you can compute two-point functions, n-point functions, particular two-point functions. Of course, the one-point function is trivial. The two-point function can start, for example, computing phi x, phi y, and this is equal to why?
Just one expression. Huh? Because A commutes with
okay.
the dagger.
And with the without looking at the expression? Because of the U1 symmetry. Because of the symmetry, this must be equal to the transformed one. The transformed one pick up a phase and the same phase from here. So you get that this is equal to a phase times itself. And this can only be true if it is zero. So if you want the whole thing, since it transforms with a phase under the symmetry, it means that it's charged. And something charged on the vacuum must be zero. Also, you can use the discrete one, which was similar to what we did. So this must be equal to phi dagger, phi dagger.
So does that mean that any n-point function
vanishes? No. Let's consider phi x, phi dagger y.
Okay, without the dagger.
Yes, without the dagger, all endpoint function of phi will be zero. And endpoint function of phi daggers alone will be zero. You have to have combinations which are neutral. So equal number of phi and phi daggers, so the total phase will be cancelled. And now you have room to have non-zero results. Of course, from here you can see now that this guy here, the contribution from this guy here comes. Phi dagger, I want to pick up the A dagger piece. And for phi, I want to pick up the A piece here. And this will give you the usual delta plus x minus y. Now you can compute phi dagger x phi y. This now will pick up a B dagger piece here, and this a B piece here, and this will give you a now let me call with opposite names y next. So this gives you y minus x, which is equal to delta minus x minus y. Okay. So that now we can consider the commutator of phi x with phi dagger y on the vacuum, which is just the difference between these two. So again, it's delta plus minus delta minus, which is exactly the same result. This is just a retarded Green function minus advanced Green function that we found in the real scalar field. It was the combination that was zero inside the Lycon and non-zero inside. Uh, The funny part of this calculation for the compact scalar field is the following. This object here is zero side icon because of a cancellation between this delta plus and delta minus. Delta plus alone and delta minus alone are in general different from zero everywhere. You remember computed here. It's like just a plane wave everywhere. Only this combination is zero outside the light cone. But you see, the zero outside the light cone comes from a cancellation between this and this, which means it's a cancellation between the propagation of a particle and the propagation of an antiparticle. So you can reinterpret a posteriori the absence of commutations outside the light cone as a cancellation of particle antiparticle. You could have done the same thing for the real scalar field, except for the real scalar field, the interpretation is that the particle is its own antiparticle. So it was doing everything by itself. Okay.
So if, let's say, our universe does not have antiparticles, so will it be a problem for
No. No, there are... at the end, we are guaranteed that the commutator is zero outside the light. This is just an interpretation.
Okay.
So in this case, it's a cancellation between particle and antiparticle. In general, it's always a cancellation between a particle and antiparticle. When you don't have antiparticle, it's because the particle is its own antiparticle. Like in the other, in that case. For example, the photon is its own antiparticle. Every particle that is represented by a real field is automatically a particle that is its own antiparticle. Instead, if it's a complex one, then there are particle antiparticle. And of course, you can now consider also the time order product of phi x and phi y, and phi dagger y, otherwise it's zero. On the vacuum, and this will give you, as before, the Feynman Green function, just exactly the same form as for the real scalar field. In this case, the interpretation, now you see that it's slightly different in the sense that when x is in the future of y, the contribution comes from this this term here, which is a propagation of a creation of particle at y annihilated at x. So in this case, there is a particle A propagating from y to x. In the case x is in the past of y, the contribution comes from this term here, which creates a particle, antiparticle at x, and annihilate the antiparticle at y. So in this case, it's a B propagating from x to y. So depending on how this two-point function, the model point function, is oriented in space-time, it describes a propagation of either a particle or antiparticle. By convention, this thing is the particle is the propagation of the particle is depicted with the arrow following the propagation of the particle, the antiparticle with the anti-arrow. In other words, the arrow always follows the flux of the charge of the particle. In this case, if the antiparticle, which has opposite charge, going this way, it means that the current of the charge is going the opposite way. We always have a line starting from phi dagger and ending and psi at x, independent if x and y. This is just a convention of drawing these propagators, but you see it become useful later.
I apply the normal ordering operator to the second vacuum expectation
here.
The one above.
Here.
Above. To that one.
Here.
I get exactly the same as the one that is below. If I apply the normal ordering operator to that one, I get exactly the same. Why? Not supposed to be invariant and stuff?
Sorry, I don't understand. So if you take a normal order of 5, 5 dagger?
I get 5 dagger, 5.
Now, if you do the normal ordering, you have a contribution from A dagger, mm-hmm. and then you have B dagger B by your normal order, it becomes B B dagger.
Ah, okay.
And also the other case. So you have both contribution, both cases, but then we.
I don't understand why the delta plus and delta minus are equal outside of the light cone.
They are not.
Okay. So they vanish?
No, sorry. No, they are zero. Why this is zero?
Yeah.
So we can rewrite this as theta of x naught minus y naught, theta plus minus theta minus theta of y naught minus x naught times delta plus minus delta minus. So, you see, put delta plus minus delta minus outside. This is the step function plus the other step function, which gives you 1 everywhere. This combination is, if you go back on the notes, is the retarded Green function. And this combination here is the advanced Green function. One is only non-zero here, and the other is only non-zero there. So outside the latitude, they're both zero. So now, if you want to see mathematically how the cancellation happened, the only fast way I know is to rewrite this as the imaginary part of this. And you remember this we computed was a Bessel function, and outside the light cone, it was exactly real. It was Bessel function of square root of minus x squared. So outside the light cone was a real function. And this you can write as the, since as this expression, yesterday we argued that it can be written as the imaginary part of this.
Mm. So they are equal outside.
Yes. Other questions? Okay, so this is all I wanted to say about quantization of spin zero fields. And now I'll start spin one half, but the first part will be very boring because I'm sure you already saw everything in the previous courses, but I need to fix all the notations and also be sure. Thank you.
Okay, so go back to Lorentz symmetry and transformations. So Lorentz transformation can be also represented more in general. So if you have the representation on vectors, can be represented as the exponentiation of the generator, epsilon, and expanded will be just the identity plus at the first order, the first term, epsilon mu nu. Epsilon mu nu is an anti-symmetric 4x4 matrix. When the both indices are either raised or lowered. And this can be rewritten as I over 2 epsilon rho sigma j rho sigma mu nu. So I rewrote basically this transformation as the parameters, the 6 parameters of rotation in boost, and a basis of generators. So these are just constant matrices. There will be 6 matrices in the representation of 4 vectors. So the generic transformation was basically e to the I over 2 epsilon dot j. Okay. This is actually the most general form for any representation. And then by specifying j into which representation, which dimension you want the representation to be, you basically all you have to do is just replace these matrices you need. So for this one, I'll give you also the explicit form. This is get it right as a combination of Kronecker, Werta, and matrix. So you can check that after you take this, you replace here, you'll get this.
What's this symbol?
Which one?
Next to the letter. Yeah, that's it.
G, the metric.
Sorry.
You don't like? So these are the generators of SO13. In the vectorial representation, in general, it satisfies an algebra, right? Which are orthogonal groups. And the algebra is G alpha gamma G beta gamma. Beta delta, sorry, minus G alpha delta J beta gamma plus G beta delta J alpha gamma minus G beta gamma J alpha delta. This is what defines basically the orthogonal group. And if you want other representation, what we have to do is to find other matrices, other generators, different dimensions that still satisfy the same algebra. So
You remember a certain point, we so the general transformation S that we used for the fields, and at a certain point we use the form e to the epsilon sigma is equivalent to this guy here. So somehow I use two different normalizations. So sigma is basically the same as j up to a factor I over 2. So basically you can replace sigma here up to I over 2, you will change the prefactor. And then you have to impose that that constraint. So what are the spin 1R representation? This can be built simply by noticing the following, that if you find four matrices called gammas that satisfy this relation, this is the anti-commutator, J gamma mu gamma nu plus gamma nu gamma mu. If this is true, then you can easily check that the combination sigma mu nu equal to, and the factor is 1a, commutator gamma mu gamma nu. This guy here satisfies the orthogonal group algebra. So the exercise just reduces to find four matrices that satisfy this. It was shown by Dirac that the smallest dimensionality matrices are 4 by 4. And with this procedure, well, you will find the transformation you're looking for. And this identity here forces basically the gamma matrix to have some properties. And these properties are the following. So if you take, for example, mu and nu equal to 0, this tells you the gamma naught must be equal to 1 times the identity. And gamma I squared must be equal to minus the identity. Gamma naught can be taken orthogonal, the emission, and gamma I anti-emission. From the anti-commutation rule, also you can derive that gamma mu dagger is equal to gamma naught, gamma mu, gamma naught. And that gamma naught, gamma I is a mission. You can also find a fifth matrix, 4 by 4, by just multiplying together all 4 gamma matrices. Let me normalize it with I in front. In this way, you show that gamma phi anti-commutes with all the other matrices, and with this normalization gamma phi is orthogonal, condition. And satisfy gamma phi squared equal to 1. Of course, we used already, so everything here, right? So I'm going fast, just in case something you didn't see, whatever, just stop me and we can discuss the rest. So if now you take a general transformation of this kind, Lorentz transformation, by lambda or epsilon, doesn't matter, and you compute the combination S minus 1 gamma mu S, you can show that this is also equal to lambda mu nu times gamma nu. It's just an identity between gamma mu. And similarly, you can show that S dagger is also equal to gamma naught, S to the minus 1 gamma naught. I assume we already saw all the derivations. And now we are in business to compute two built invariants. So these are 4x4 matrices, which means there are four components, so called the spinors, psi alpha, that under Lorentz transformation transforms with this representation. If psi is complex, psi dagger will transform with in this way, with S dagger, but because of this identity, then means that this is also equal to this combination. And if we define psi dagger gamma naught as psi bar, the property of psi bar under the transformation, Lorentz transformation, is just transform with the inverse S to the minus 1. So now it will be easy to construct invariant out of psi bar and psi. For example, psi bar psi is a Lorentz invariant. Then you can construct other combination of indices of spinors, for example, psi bar gamma psi. And a Lorentz transformation, this will go to psi bar S minus 1 gamma mu S psi. And using this identity, you'll see that this transform as lambda mu nu, psi bar mu psi, which means that this combination here transforms as a vectorial, a vector, a Lorentz vector. And you can go on. Considering bilinear psi bar and psi with two gamma matrices, you take a symmetric part. This is proportional to the anticommutator, which is proportional to g mu nu. So up to a constant, go back to the invariant here. So the only non-trivial combination is the commutator part, the anti-symmetric part. And this, if you repeat the same exercise, it will transform as an anti-symmetric tensor. It can go on with 3 and 4. Let's take the guy with three gamma matrices. When I don't write the gamma matrices, I just add the indices, means that I take an anti-symmetric, complete anti-symmetric combination. This anti-symmetric combination is equivalent to writing gamma phi gamma sigma, epsilon, sigma, mu, mu, rho. Because gamma sigma, gamma phi evolve the gamma matrices, So the product with gamma sigma will remove one, it will be left with the other three anti-symmetrized. And this will transform as an anti-symmetric tree tensor. This will transform like a vector. Like a pretense. So you can actually consider the other case, smooth testing, epsilon mu rho sigma, mu sigma. So you can construct, you can combine with epsilon here. So this will transform as a pseudo vector. So transform as a vector, but because of the epsilon tensor, there will be also the determinant of lambda. And this is encoded in gamma phi, which encode an epsilon tensor here, or if you want, this product will produce a determinant of lambda. And finally, you can consider psi bar gamma phi psi, which is also the product of all the gamma matrices and the symmetrized, and this will transform as epsilon scalar. In total, you have 1 plus 4 plus 6 plus 4 plus 1 components objects, right? 1 here, 4 here, this is anti-symmetric 6, this is equivalent to 4, this is equivalent to 1. If you sum, you get 16, and these 16 are match with the most general 4 times 4, 16 bilinear you build. So this represents the full basis of bilinear psi bar psi. Rarely, but sometimes it's useful to have a explicit representation of the gamma matrices. There are several one can use. And on dimension 2, one is called Dirac-Pauli, Pauli-Dirac. So, in this representation, gamma naught is of the form identity minus identity, 0, 0. These are 4 by 4 matrices. Each of these blocks is 2 by 2. So this is the identity in two dimensions. The whole thing is 4 dimensional. And gamma I is 0, sigma I minus sigma I, 0. And the sigma I is the Pauli matrix. Gamma phi is the product of everything and has the form 0 identity, identity 0. What about the generators of the Lorentz group? Sigma ij, which are associated to rotations, has the form of minus I over 4. Epsilon ijk, this is anti-symmetric tensor 3 by 3, times sigma k, 0. And the other three associated to boosts, instead, have form 1 quarter
0.
Sigma i 0. So this basis is mostly convenient when you have, we will see, when you have a non-relativistic particle. Because in this basis, the upper and lower components of the four spinors are mixed under boosts. So for in the non-relativistic limit, boosts are small, and this basis basically is blocked the diagonal in the upper and lower components. In principle, any other representation of the Lorentz of the gamma matrix can be obtained from one, like this one, by just using unitary transformations on the left and the right of the gamma matrices, because if you take a gamma matrix and you multiply by u dagger on one side and the other, the anti-commutation relation is not, you will stay the same. So the new matrices will also satisfy the anti-commutation relation. And another representation we'll use later is called by. In this case, gamma mu has the form 0 sigma mu, sigma bar mu 0, where sigma mu is, for mu equal to 0, is equal to the identity. And for the other component are the Pauli matrices. And sigma bar mu is the same except the minus sign in the spatial part. So you see the spatial part of gamma I, the sigma I, minus sigma I, is the same as this. Instead, gamma naught is also off the diagonal in this representation. Gamma phi, instead, in this representation, is diagonal. And the Lorentz representation in this case are sigma ij is equal to the other one because the spatial part didn't change. And the boosts are now also blocked by diagonal.
Will basis and chiral basis same?
I think so, yes.
I got frequently got some.
Okay. Now, if you go back to the definitions of, to the properties of gamma matrices, or as apparent in this representation, you can see that gamma phi commutes with all the sigmas. Which means that gamma phi can be diagonalized, and different eigenvalues of gamma 5 will actually represent to irreducible representation of the Lorentz loop, which means that the four vectors are actually that we built in this way are not irreducible representation of the Lorentz loop are not irreducible. The actually reducible representations are the eigenvector of gamma 5 in this basis. So I guess also this you did everything. So for example, if you can write the combination epsilon mu nu sigma mu nu as, so if you call epsilon ij rk, if you call rk the three rotations that are related to the spatial part of epsilon ij, so the vector here, the derivative factor of 2, and bk the boost, which are this component of epsilon, then if you compute epsilon mu sigma mu, which is in the exponent of the Lorentz transformation, this has the form in the Weyl basis, we have the form of e to the, sorry, I times r vector plus ib vector times sigma vector over 2, 0, 0, I r vector minus ib vector times sigma vector over 2.
What's R and what's B?
R and B are the parameters of rotation and boosts inside the Lorentz transformation. Mm-hmm. So the general Lorentz transformation has 6 parameters, epsilon mu nu. I'm just calling the 3 rotation 1, which is special part R, and the 3 that are boost B. Okay? So there are 2 vectors, R and B, which are all the generators of rotation and boosts. So in this basis here, this product, epsilon mu sigma mu nu, has this form, by just replacing the component here. So which means that when you write S, which is e to the epsilon sigma, you just exponentiate that, and you find e to the I, let me write it alpha times sigma over 2, and here e to the I alpha star sigma over 2, where alpha is defined as r plus ib. So you see that now under a general Lorentz transformation, the four vector transforms as a direct product of B spinors, psi 1 and psi 2. Each one transforms as with the SU2 rotation, but with complex parameter. So this is equivalent to an SL2 transformation, which indeed is equivalent to SO13. So the smallest representation of the Lorentz group of SM2C is actually B spinor, which transforms in this way or this way. So why didn't I start from here, which are the actual irreducible representation of the Lorentz group? As we will see, these representations are only useful if you have, you see, particles, fields, which are, you cannot use this representation if you have particles which have a mass and they are charged. So, because the mass, what the mass will do, it will be, it will mix these two, so you cannot have at the same time a representation of P1R which is irreducible with mass and charge. So either if you have mass, then the automatically you see that there will be no conserved charge associated to this to the particle, or if there is a charge, then it must be massless. Since in the standard model the particle we see are all massive and charged, they'll all be described by four vector speed. There is an exception, which is neutrinos, that will be discussed separate. Last thing. Of course, the transformation of the spinors, as you see, under rotation are of SU2 type. So you see that if you perform a rotation of 2 pi, alpha will be 2 pi, but because of the 1 half, psi will go. Minus itself, which is a sign that actually this representation indeed is P1R. The P1R because the eigenvalues of the Lorentz of the rotations inside the Lorentz transformation are eigenvalues plus or minus 1R. Instead, if you combine, for example, two spinors into, for example, B spinors with a gamma mu vector, these things under a 2 pi rotation will go into this guy, which is equal to itself. So indeed, this combination here transforms as a spin, an integer spin. Representation P1 in this case. Okay, so now that I did the boring part, almost finished. Tomorrow, less boring.